5. Chagall as exemplar of psychic totality, opposites in transformation and the quest for unity. This section will be a tenuous attempt to apply the critical approach proposed in the sections above, proposing that erotic unity, as depicted in the works of Marc Chagall, embodies the Schillerian principle of total synthesis between sense and form, particular and universal, and the external objective and internal subjective world of fantasy, and comes as close as is possible to a visual demonstration of Kant's free play of the faculties, much like Moby Dick, or the surrealistic songs of Townes Van Zandt. Chagall's depictions of lovers give very little information to the viewer, but bombard the senses with imagery that demands interpretation, thus drawing the image away from any particular interpretation. In their indeterminacy, they embody the complete range of possible subject scenarios. His motifs direct the mind beyond all determinate structures, and straight to the form primitive, as described in Ramachandran's theory of art. 5.1. Theoretical frame. In this section, we will briefly examine the concept of eros as a primary drive toward unity, harmony, symmetry, and the reconciliation and synthesis of perceived oppositions, both within the individual psyche and in the social world of which the individual is an inseparable part, and its many obstacles and failures, as they are presented in the surrealist mystic visions of Chagall, the literary myths of Ovid, and the traditional ballads which survived in oral transmission until recently in the Appalachian region, as sung by Jean Ritchie. Drawing from a general theoretical framework rooted in Jung's analytical psychology, Piaget's constructivist developmental psychology, Levi Strauss's theory of binary mediation, this analysis will attempt to synthesize these structuralist theories of internal psychological processes with the deconstructive project, accounting for the ways in which myth, symbol and narrative can be both the essential foundations of human growth and positive transformation, as well as the means by which arbitrary and fallacious structures are projected onto the world, resulting in a disjunction and asymmetry between individuals and the social body in which they exist. By straddling the fence between essentialism and constructionism, it will hopefully be possible to establish a critical perspective which can be radically critical of the end to which art is often turned, and the ways in which our narratives justify or eternalize existing social orders, while simultaneously recognizing the generative structures of consciousness and the common emotional life of humankind from which the symbols and narrative structures arise as a vital, essential, and positive generative force, which form the unconscious basis for all human growth and positive development, thus also constituting a normative basis for criticism and resistance, through creative activity, to the repressive and life-negating forces which surround us. In this way we may, without in any sense becoming conservatives or Platonists, work toward the establishment of a truly life-affirming aesthetics, capable of recognizing the infinite variations of culture as the manifestations of a common, inherited, creative inner life. 5.2. Love suspended in timeless merit. The theme which exemplifies this primary drive for unity is that of the lovers, a theme which Marc Chagall, 1887-1985, painted obsessively throughout his very long life, primarily inspired by his relationship with his first wife, Bella, of whom he said, "Her eyes are mine, her silence is mine, I feel she has known me always, my childhood, my present life, my future, as though she were watching over me, divining my innermost being, though this is the first time I have seen her. I knew this was she, my wife. Her pale coloring, her eyes, how big and round and black they are my eyes, my soul in these works, the boundaries between lover, beloved, world and time are obscured. The lovers stand, or more often float, often with bodies merged, both with soft, androgynous features, the boundaries of which seem to grow out of the surrounding darkness, to draw their semiotic sustenance through the thick substance of night from the miniature worlds that float around them." These images exemplify Noman's ideal characterization of the artist's psyche, in which the ego, fully formed, descends again into the self, into the world of unitary experience that precedes the emergence of ego consciousness, where the boundaries between self and mother, mother and world are not fully formed, drawing the contents of the creative act from the generative depths of the unconscious. The dream lore of his paintings flows from a unity of feeling, reflected not only in the intrinsic color development but also in the relationship between the symbols that order themselves around the symbolic center of the picture. The unity and force of conviction in his pictures are an expression of the obedience with which he accepts the intention of his unconscious. The metaphor of the artist's created world as a partial reconstruction of the original identity with the mother is attested by Chagall's answer when he was asked what has driven you as an artist. His only answer was, "My mother loved me and believed in me, and I wanted to justify myself in her eyes." With the exception of his terrible 5-year relationship with Virginia McNeil, from 1945, shortly after Bella's death, until 1952, when he met Valentine Vavabrodsky, who would remain with him until his death, Chagall's career divides into two halves of roughly 3 decades, throughout both of which he had a partner willing to take on this role, to act as the source of creative inspiration by accepting his projections. This is not to say that Chagall himself was a perfect human being. When he found out that Virginia was leaving him, he beat her repeatedly. Nevertheless, though his massive ego and violent temper clearly do not embody the principles we are observing in his work, his life as a whole, perhaps out of pure luck, seems to have unfolded in a perfect symmetry which reflects the vision he expressed in his paintings. These depictions of love will be our central point of reference. This symbolic expression of perfect wholeness can be seen as a perfect form, all-embracing, neither moving nor motionless, which contains the latent potential for all of the possible stories, beautiful, tragic, and revolting, that could result as soon as the contents are thrown into disequilibrium. We will consider the other works as symbolic processes which strive toward the unity of Chagall's mystic vision, but for various reasons negated in the process. In Ovid's Paramus and Thespian, the ballad Dirosini, The House Carpenter, and False Sir John, sung by Jean Ritchie, we will see just a few of the transformations which the characters in these stories move through as the symbolic structures of the narrative strive for the unity exemplified in Chagall's master form, and fail. In these examples, the failures come in two forms. The first, in the ballads of courting, deceit and murder, False Sir John and The House Carpenter being total disequilibrium, when one pole in a symbolic opposition totally negates or assimilates its opposite, in Pagetian terms, an allegorical representation of the failure to establish a line of equilibration between the perceptual poles of assimilation and accommodation. In Jungian terms, the domination of the self by an unchecked, hypertrophied complex. And the second, in the stories of forbidden love and suicide told in Ovid's Paramus and Thespian Dirosini, being total negation, when the natural drive toward unification is violently repressed in order to serve the ends of a superordinate order, with tragic results, the total domination of the self by a tyrannical persona and the compensatory immersion of the entire personality into the unconscious, which manifests at the collective level in the form of institutional domination over the lives, identities, and relationships of human beings. Like Plotinus Scintilla emanating from the One, we can imagine these distorted and stifled attempts among the microcosmic paintings within paintings that fade in and out of focus, embedded in the opaque boundary of night that surrounds the figures at the center of Chagall's paintings, submerged in the darkness just below the threshold of perception, crying enviously through many eternities as they gaze up through the images of Chagall's childhood in Vitebsk, through the other, to see love suspended between heaven and earth, past and future, light and darkness, poised upon Eliot's still point of the turning world. All of the images of the village and its animals, of the fertile earth emerging out of the depths of unconscious night, to culminate not in the brutal conquest of the darkness by the light, nor in the absorption of all things by the dark, but by the perfect synthesis of unity and multiplicity, in which the boundaries of self and other, past and present, earth and heaven remain. but emerge together as part of one indissoluble whole as they melt into the soft obscurity of moonlight. 5.3. Omnipresence, pregnant with the future, points of narrative departure in Chagall's Elatent. The title of Chagall's Elatent, Waiting, is unremarkable and ambiguous. The painting depicts a couple, apparently lovers, walking together in the night, a motif which makes up the subject matter of an immense quantity of his work, and the one for which he is best known, so much so that more than a few people probably don't know that he painted anything else. Ironically, the positions of the characters in the painting, the ambivalent mood that it conveys, and the eeriness of the kinds of images that emerge out of the dark perimeter stand in marked contrast to many of his other depictions of this theme. Most of his other works on this theme place the two lovers in direct embrace, and often physically merge together, as in La Champ de Mars, in which the faces of the lovers overlap, the man's face seemingly growing out of the woman's head, whose body is marked only by a lighter hued section of the blue-tinted night that surrounds them, rising up out of the village below, embraced by a crescent moon on the left and a full moon, or perhaps the sun, on the right. They appear as though they will always be right there, as though all that had come before and all that could be had dropped out of time, leaving only Paris. Vitebsk, an earthy peasant mother, the ever-present fertility rooster, and the lovers, hovering therein and changing bliss. The subject's gender features are often obscured into a soft mutual androgyny. In La Champ de Mars, the two heads share one hand, and one cannot tell who gave the bouquet of flowers to whom. The merged bodies are usually indistinguishable from the night itself, which surrounds and pervades everything as though it were not simply the absence of light, but a tangible substance. In Blue Landscape, 1949, the lovers have no bodies at all. As their bodies are submerged into the night, the faint image of a second set of lovers rises emerges out of the dark behind them. The subject matter shifts in relation to its surroundings as elements in the field of vision sink into darkness and unconsciousness, and new variations on the subject emerge from the dark. The animals, which are almost always present in Chagall's paintings, merge into the surrounding night just like their human companions, and often merge completely with other objects in the paintings. The moon in Blue Landscape is a fish swimming through the night sky, which, in turn, merges with the ocean below. In another painting, also entitled Blue Landscape, 1958, the moon merges with the lovers themselves, and the night is illuminated by a clock, presumably motionless. In others, such as The Rooster in Love, 1947, lovers, animals, earth and sky form one great mass. Every entity remains distinguishable, and the differences between the subjects do not simply disappear. The structure of the scene maintains itself without ever falling into abstraction, but all oppositions have disappeared. Sets of opposites have transformed into an interconnected tapestry of harmonious contrasts, in which the boundaries of the characters merge together. Above, below, light, darkness, human and animal, conscious and unconscious, male and female are, in these paintings, inseparable components of a unified organic whole. In contrast to these visions of perfect unity, Elatent has the pair walking in the same direction. As in the other paintings, neither is touching the ground. The woman's body emerges out of the night, over the distant village. The entire lower body of the man is hidden behind the donkey that walks beside him, and the entire upper body of the woman is surrounded by a green rooster, which floats behind her, filling the background of the painting. The boundaries between the characters and their surroundings are as obscure as in other paintings, but in this one, the lovers are not merged together, nor are they even in physical contact. They are not facing one another. The woman floats ahead of and above the man, who is much smaller than she is. He stands back with a slightly bewildered look on his pale face with his arm around his donkey, who gazes out of the canvas with a sort of sly, mysterious squint and a half smile, like the Mona Lisa would have if she were a donkey. In response to Chagall's other love paintings, one might reasonably expect viewers to divide more or less consistently into two groups, one of which is sentimental and inclined toward mystic obfuscation, which will view the work as profound, and another group which is cynical, practical, inclined to think that these images serve only as a distraction from the many problems of the world which urgently need to be addressed. This painting, however, does not share the sense of quaint, blissful certainty. Its most alluring, as well as its most terrifying aspect is the uncertainty which pervades it. The darkness, which in all of these paintings clings around the bodies of the lovers, in this painting also lies between them and separates them. Aside from their animals, the objects in the periphery are obscured by the dark, which serves as the only boundary frame in the scene. What at one moment brought the figures into focus suddenly becomes a source of ambivalence. All of the unconscious variables by which we could know the true nature of the situation lie outside of our view, as well as that of the characters. In such an atmosphere of uncertainty, they might be happy, but are they, the beautiful, in the eye of the observer, constantly transforms into the obscene, the sublime into the ridiculous, and the quaintly romantic into the horrific and unspeakable. Without the clarity of intent characteristic of Chagall's other lovers, the quaint romance story which presents itself at a casual glance can only be preserved in the mind of the viewer by the most astute suspension of judgment, by the careful silencing of all improper or disturbing thoughts. It is in this place, where the motif of unity has been thrown out of balance, where the inevitable play of opposites begins. While sublime bliss is out of the question, a love story is still possible, but not inevitable. It could, at any moment, transform suddenly into a comedy of failed romance, or a murderous stalker scenario. One finds oneself continuously asking just what are they doing in the dark with all those animals. The woman's hand is raised across her heart, and she holds a bouquet of flowers in her hand. At first, it appears that he has given her the flowers, and she is gushing over the sweet gesture. But why is she turned away from him? Has he brought her all the way out here in the moonlight just to give her flowers and then tell her he's leaving her? Or has he given her flowers, only to find out she's leaving him? But the ambiguity of their situation is the least of our problems. With a few minutes staring at the canvas, it becomes clear that the tail of the rooster in front of her forms the head and enormous beard of a faunish, or perhaps centaurish looking figure, whose form is made up only of the ripples in the darkness. It now appears as though this sinister common animus figure really gave her the flowers, and she is turning from her puny, inadequate lover, with his silly donkey, and preparing to run off with a demon lover. But then, with a few more minutes staring, one sees that this figure actually has his arms around a nude female figure. He has his left hand wrapped around her vulva, and his right hand wrapped around the moon, which hangs vulva-like next to a village tower, which bears an uncanny resemblance to a penis. Without being able to say what is actually going on here, it is certainly evident that the quaintness has disappeared, and the unsettling and potentially very creepy aspects of night and unconsciousness have taken over. Having been led by the master of unity and bliss himself to this unsettling and ambivalent place, let us now explore some of the ways in which the symbolic quest for unity ends in utter disequilibrium and failure. 5.4. Lured beyond the boundaries and cut into tiny pieces, the murderer's rake. The story of the ravishing young man who lures a naive girl away from her home and, out of pure, demonic malice, either stabs her, bashes in her head, poisons her, throws her in the river, takes her out to sea and drowns her, drags her to hell, or any combination of these heinous acts, always comes to its climax in a scene much like the one in Chagall's Lovers, in the dark, far from home, in the wilderness or out at sea, in what the girl assumed would be a love scene. Suddenly and unexpectedly, he turns around and reveals that his intention all along has been to brutally murder her, usually without any explanation. In the demon lover, or the house carpenter, the woman, married to a house carpenter, is convinced that she should leave her husband and go to sea with her former lover, who has returned after a long absence, but when they get out to sea, she begins to weep, longing for the three babies that she has abandoned, at which point her lover reveals his demonic nature, sinks the ship, and drags her down to hell with him. In false Sir John, and the variants May Colvin and Lady Isabel in the Elf Knight, the girl, May Colvin, is convinced by false Sir John that she should take all of her father's money and elope with him. After they set out, they stop on a cliff, where he announces his intention to drown her, as he has done to seven other women. He instructs her first to remove her expensive clothing, for it's too fine and costly to rot in the sea with you. She convinces him that he should be a gentleman and turn around while she undresses, and then runs up behind him and pushes him into the sea, mocking him as he begs for help. No help, no help, oh false Sir John, no help will you get from me, for the bed's no colder to you, sir, than you thought to give to me. This is an interesting gender role reversal, the inverse of its twin story. The female plays the role of trickster and masculine hero, and the darkness becomes a liminal space, in which she transgresses social and gender norms, returning to the safety of home unharmed by her aggressor, and unpunished for her own transgression. At the intersubjective level, these stories have a clear social function, the first clearly stating, if you go very far from home, especially for the purpose of having sex, you will die a violent death and be dragged down to hell, and you will deserve it. The second, using the same story structure, functions to openly flout the values expressed in the first. Structurally, in either case, the polarities are in a state of constant motion and conflict. The values of home and social life, in conflict with her desire for freedom, are either upheld or undermined through symbolic negation of one figure in an opposing pair by another. Total annihilation in the cause of unity, nature's eternal refusal of culture in Pyramus and Thisbe, and Dirosini Ovid's tale of Pyramus and Thisbe 55 takes place in a frame of unsettling darkness, much like the scene in Chagall's painting. Ultimately, it is uncertainty and unconsciousness which led to the lover's demise. The natural course of Eris, the driving force compelling the lovers toward one another, has been cut off in process in the story. The young lovers, living in connected houses, are forbidden to see one another, their emerging sexuality having been appropriated and planned in terms of its commodity value years before, by families for which mate selection is a matter of institutional priority, a political and business transaction, but that which Eris wants, Eris seeks out, finding a way either through or around externally constructed barriers. But, in the process of this displacement, it is distorted, forced into the dark, having agreed, speaking through a tiny hole in the wall, to meet and run away together. Thisbe waits in the dark for her lover, by the mulberry tree where they had agreed to meet. Running to hide from a lioness, she drops a veil, and the lioness runs off with it in her bloody jaws. Pyramus, believing she has been devoured, stabs himself to death, and Thisbe, upon finding his body, does the same. The living force of conscious life has been stifled and distorted in this narrative by the arbitrary divisions of culture, with the contents of the narrative prevented from forming a structural arrangement through which Eris can flow. The characters are forced into the dark, outside all the boundaries of civilized life, underdeveloped and wrapped about in fear and ignorance. The opposites achieve unity only through mutual negation. A perverse symmetry has nonetheless established itself here. Facing one another across the wall, the opposites, seeking unification at all costs, make a circuit through the wilderness. Having been denied unity in conscious life, they merge together again beyond the boundaries of civilization, their blood pouring together in death. The final outcome of this story is that the mulberry tree gets its color from the blood of the sacrifice. It is in the sense of fertility myth, all of civilization's structures being founded on the distortion and rechanneling of the forces of human life to serve the ends of institutions over which they have no control. A similar story is told in the ballad Farewell, Dear Orsini, with notable variations, but the same basic story structure. Whereas Pyramus and Thisbe ends in the darkness where Chagall leaves off, the ballad opens with this scene. Jean Ritchie's unaccompanied voice, angelic but not overly cultivated, singing in the wide, leaping intervals typical of the child balance, seems to echo eerily through the thick darkness of the opening scene, as Chagall's thick, swirling night twists about in the wide spaces between the notes, filling the silence between the phrases as it does the space between the couple in Ella Tent. We must use our imaginations, as she did not record this song. Alamanda, Rossini's lover, stands outside her window in the night. This opening scene is a motif all its own, which can serve as a point of departure for a number of contrasting scenarios, such as the Night Visitor song, or its parent ballad Sweet William's Ghost, in which the visitor approaches his lover's window in the night, briefly unites with her in blissful Chagall-esque union, and as quickly departs when Chagall's ever-present rooster begins to crow. The first line after the opening chorus, and as he came up to his true love's window, which promises to be a lovely tale, so long as we are able to presume that his true love reciprocates this sentiment, also opens up some disturbing possibilities. Not a sound. I am Sextus Tarquinius. I am armed. If you utter a word, I will kill you. In Farewell, Dear Rossini, however, the Night Visitor scene only lasts two verses, in which it is established that, like Pyramus and Thisbe, Rossini and Alamanda have been forbidden to consummate their love by Rossini's parents, who have arranged her marriage to a nobleman. As he expresses his despair, Rossini's parents come to the window and tell him that Rossini is already married. Alamanda, in his despair, decides to go to sea, and is drowned in a gale the very next morning. One sailor survives, floats back on a hogshead, and spreads the news that all of the sailors have been lost at sea. When Rossini hears this, she shouts out a curse against cruel parents, and all of the social ties to which they sacrifice their children's lives, as she stabs herself to death. She pulled out her dagger and pierced her body through Rossini's blood sprinkled like an evening dew, crying curse cruel parents wherever they may be. They all slight their own children in many a degree. Again, we have a natural structure through which an essential and vital guiding force of life seeks to manifest itself, stifled from above by a subordinating structure. At the level of archetypal symbol, the self in its entirety has been crushed and suffocated beneath an externally oriented persona, and of course, at the socio-cultural level, the very real and tangible subordination of human beings' lives and wills to the designs of institutions whose only functions are to expand their boundaries of domination, and to rank all things within these boundaries under their mechanistic hierarchies. The natural unifying function of air is thus displaced under contextualized. Unity becomes impossible within a crippled and distorted structure. Unification transforms into annihilation, and air is becomes death. Whether they pay their rhetorical lip service to the external determinism of the social theorists, or conversely to the internal determinism of medical psychiatry is of little import. What matters is that we as living, feeling, dreaming human beings are surrounded on all sides by corporations, states, educational institutions, and their willing foot soldiers, who want nothing more than to create a world devoid of all human emotion. By embracing as positive and liberating the notion that there is a human nature which manifests itself through the emotional life, not as a dictatorship of the sex organs, but as a positive, generative life force which drives us to seek out community, companionship, happiness, and liberation from the forces that impede us in these ends, we may conceivably, with much luck and struggle, be able to resist these forces of estrangement and alienation. We can begin by seeing the products of human creativity not simply as mirrors of the social structure, or vessels for the delivery of propaganda, though they are quite clearly turned to those purposes, but rather as the means by which we can take the world as it presents itself, and transform it through creative response, creating the templates for a future which we must choose to create. The politicians are unskilled and oafish sculptors who, with blunt chisels, use living souls as the medium for their hideous crafts. A better world will not be created by people who reduce all art to an epiphenomenon of the episteme, but only by people who have embraced the world of feeling as something living and vital, and learned how to turn the world outside into the reflection of this inward beauty. The better we know this creative life, the better able we will be to know when it is being turned toward malevolent and deceptive ends, and the better we will be able to reclaim it as a force of transcendence. We can begin by declaring unequivocally the notion that aesthetics, by its very nature, lends itself to fascism. 65 is simply slanderous and fallacious. Life is susceptible to misdirection and misuse, but only ascetics and intellectuals think they can cure it by refusing to live. Let us reclaim, without shame or fear, the antiquated notion that life is beautiful and progress is possible, and may all who disagree go and stab themselves to death in the dark.